Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, to light the lamp of our souls with the oil of charity, like the wise virgins to await you, O heavenly bridegroom, anxiously and visionly to enter your coming, your kingdom filled with joy. We will offer glory and thanksgiving to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen.
Father, for us, have mercy on us, O Lord, and assist us. O harbor of salvation and port of safety, you are the lighthouse that draws us to you with the radiance of your light. Above the stormy seas of this world, enlighten us with the splendor of your face in your kingdom to come, where peace and harmony reign. We offer glory to you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our hope in lies.
kind is Christ Jesus our Lord.
He brings salvation and grants us life. He ascends to his Father on high. He will return in glorious splendor and shed his light on those gazing upon him.
Thy happiness and the joy of the upright is Christ Jesus our Lord.
The light of the just and the joy of the upright is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Baruch Morabun, have mercy on us, O Lord, and assist us. O Lord, on the day when we meet you, do not extinguish the lights of our lamp. O heavenly bridegroom, fill our lamps with your oil of your divine love, that we may remain with you until the end. You are our Lord and God. To you be glory forever.
Amen. So is this a straight film?
Alleluia.
All merciful one, open your door to those who shed their tears, as you did for the repenting woman. Be pleased with our sacrifice and accept the penance of our heart, as you accepted the songs of David the just.
Alleluia.
Let them meet you in the radiance.
Kyrie eleison.
Sea of mercy and compassion, in your abundant generosity and eternal kindness, hearts, you comfort those who grieve, suffer, and seek refuge in you. O harbor of safety and salvation, through this incense we now offer you, be a support and a savior to all those who came in true faith to the harbor of your holy church. As we commemorate your saving passion for us, we offer glory to you forever.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be announced to you.
Listen and give glory and thanks to the word of the living God.
The Apostle Matthew writes, "And leaving them, Jesus went out of the city to Bethany, and there he spent the night. When he was going back into the city in the morning, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went over to it, but found nothing on it except leaves. Excuse me. And he said to it, 'May no fruit ever come from you again.' And immediately the fig tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed. And they said, 'How was it that the fig tree withered immediately?' Jesus said to them in reply, 'Amen, I say to you, if you have faith and do not waver, not only will you do what has been done to this fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, "Be lifted up and thrown into the sea," it shall be done. Whatever you ask for in prayer with faith, you shall receive.' When he had come into the temple area, the chief priests and the elders of the people approached him as he was teaching and said, 'By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?' Jesus said to them in reply, 'I shall ask you one question, and if you answer it for me, then I shall tell you by what authority I do these things. Where was John's baptism from? Was it of heavenly or of human origin?' They discussed this among themselves and said, 'If we say of heavenly origin, he will say to us, "Then why did you not believe him?" But if we say of human origin, we fear the crowd, because they all regard John as a prophet.' So they said to Jesus in reply, 'We do not know.' He himself said to them, 'Neither then shall I tell you by what authority I do these things.' This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, for giving us his words and life.
Neither shall I tell you by what authority I do these things. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This Gospel of St. Matthew actually picks up where we leave off on Palm Sunday, which is why the first line says that our Lord at the end of it returns and goes back to Bethany. He goes back to stay at the house of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, of course, who's back home now. It's when he returns the next day, which is Monday, which is why we have the Gospel to this day, that we have this confrontation. We have this strange episode with the fig tree, and then the apostles watch it wither up. Remember, this is during Passion Week. This is the moment in which the final confrontation is coming together between the authorities in the temple and, of course, the Messiah himself. The fig tree represents Israel. Israel is represented as a fig tree in the prophet Isaiah and the prophet Jeremiah. So, being attentive to the word of God and the prophets, the apostles would already have an understanding. And if not they, because their education perhaps was limited, the priests and the scribes would know exactly what the fig tree represents, being withered up by our Lord's cursing it. He finds it full, it has leaves everywhere, but there's no fruit. It's an unusual thing because, in fact, in another gospel, it will say the apostles are kind of wondering why our Lord cursed it, because it wasn't time for figs anyways. They're later in the season. And what our Lord is pointing out is that you must be ready always. This attentiveness that we've said in these different hymns and these different verses, waiting for our Lord's return. Now the Messiah is here, present. God is present among them in the city of God, in Jerusalem. And all he finds is lushness of leaves, but really no fruit, nothing. So he is unsatisfied. Notice that the evangelist, St. Matthew, the apostle, tells us, our Lord is hungry. He's looking for satisfaction on the spiritual level. He's looking for the satisfaction, not of himself personally, but that the fruit be produced by Israel, which after all has been led by God for 15 centuries. You think you get it together at some point. And when the Messiah arrives and finds fullness, temple, the most beautiful temple of the three to have been built on the site, leaves, just leaves. So our Lord curses this tree as a symbolism to remind the apostles that the church, the new Israel, will have to pray for profound faith and for this confidence in God to produce fruit by its charity. Do not be like the old assembly, the Kahal of the Old Testament, but the new assembly, the new Israel, the body of Christ, has to always be producing fruit. Israel itself, as you've watched in the symbolism, has withered. That's why our Lord says, you marvel at this. He says, if you were to say to this mountain, Jerusalem is built on a hill. If you were to say to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, it would be done if your faith were such as to accomplish it. So he's reminding the apostles is that you cannot be like Israel has been. This is the clash. This is God himself saying, I am not satisfied with 15 centuries of teachers and prophets and kings and inspired word and the law of Moses and the appearance on Mount Sinai and leading them for an entire two generations throughout the desert for 40 years. I am not pleased. But the priests are in the temple, they're not pleased either. Because they say, everyone's following after him, this is going to tick off the Romans, they're going to come in, abolish our positions, and just take over the whole kingdom. And then where will we be? We're not going to have our nice camps at Jericho. We're not going to be able to have our good salaries from the temple. They are thinking of their personal positions of authority, not that they are authorities in the name of God. Which is why if you go back and read St. Matthew, what happens just before this episode with the fig tree is that when our Lord enters the temple in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, St. Matthew puts the cleansing of the temple at the end of the 3 years. But it's reported in the other Gospels it's the beginning of the 3 years. But St. Matthew reports it as being the end of our Lord's descent into the Valley of Josaphat, up into Jerusalem, and then he goes in and starts dumping over the tables because you've made this a profane place of merchandising. Do you have to remember that what they're doing in the temple, they're not in the holiest place. The temple has the Holy of Holies, it has the holy place, that's the actual building. Then you have the court of Israel, that's where the men would be. And then you have the court of the women, that's where the women of Israel would be. Then you have the open esplanade where the Gentiles could be. And it's those places and those market. If you're coming from Libya, if you're coming from Rome, you're not going to carry a lamb with you the whole time. When you arrive, you have money from a different country. You exchange your money like you do when you travel internationally now. This is what they were doing in the esplanade. And they also had animals for sale. You could buy your doves. You could buy your lambs. You could buy your goats. Whatever you're sacrificing, you could also buy them. But what our Lord pointed out to them is the corruption of their heart. What they're doing in itself was not forbidden. In fact, it was a service to the temple. What he was pointing out was the corruption of their heart is you are doing this personally for your personal gain. These foreigners come in, you get to make something off of it, and you're making more than you should. The same way that the priests are in the temple, and they are worried that Roman authorities are going to come and just simply abolish the whole Judaic system, which of course they do 40 years later. But not because of our Lord. And because of that, our Lord dumps over the tables. That's what he's doing, calling it a den of thieves. You're looking for profit. You're looking to, what does a thief do? A thief obtains things that don't belong to him. He tries to seek a profit for which he has not worked. That's why he calls this a den of thieves. That's what he does on Palm Sunday in the Gospel of St. Matthew. And then we have that beautiful little line, and then he went back to Bethany. So he overturns everything, causes this huge stir, and then goes back and has dinner with Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And then the next day coming back, he has this episode with the fig tree. That's why now the priests are like, well, this is ridiculous. You tell us by what authority you can just come here and start shoving people around. Remember in the Gospel of St. John, we're told that our Lord makes a rope. He makes a whip to whip these people on that day when he's overturning the tables. None of this is, you know, what you think of religion as being sweet and, I just love this hymn. You know, it's none of this. It's the confrontation of what is the will of God. So as we come into the harbor and we contemplate our Lord's passion this week, read the Gospels, read the four Gospels in your time, make spare time, to read each of the nuances by the apostles portraying the passion of our Lord's betrayal, of our Lord's sufferings. Each of them are actually quite different. They all tell obviously the same story, but they tell them from slightly different ways. And St. Luke is very talkative. Lots of people involved in it because he's interviewed the people who were there. But this clash that takes place as our Lord is revealing to us what true religion is the disposition of heart. What is the reserve of oil that we have in our lamp? Except that we build up that lushness of the presence of God's grace within us that can be illuminated at any moment. Whether it's midnight, whether it's in the moment that we walk towards the banquet feast, or whether we think it's taking too long and we're just waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, our lamp will still not burn out. It's a question of will. It's a question of mind. What do we see? What do we choose? What do we love? There is nothing in our Lord in his feelings this week that make him want to head to Jerusalem and into Calvary and his passion. We know that because St. Luke gives us the entire portrayal of our Lord's agony in the garden and the sweat of blood. This is crushing to our Lord, who yes is God, but is also man. And the overwhelming aspect, not just simply of the physical suffering, but the betrayal of the very people who have been closest to him, for whom he has had this love and this teaching, offering them the oil to fill their lamps. And in fact, when we read the Passion, we know that all of the lamps of all the apostles went out. The only lamp that's still lit on Calvary is that of the Mother of God. Every other one, including Mary Magdalene and John, they are there at the cross because they have an affection for our Lord, but they don't believe in the resurrection. They just see this as being a horrible tragedy. What they do is great compared to everybody else running away. But what they do is still insufficient. They do not believe. Only the Mother of God believes during this passion. We'll talk about this a bit on Good Friday. And so what we do is seeing the context of this, what I want to leave you with, if you go back and read the context of this gospel today of the fig tree, is that then our Lord gives the parable. This whole question with the Pharisees and the priests. I will answer your question if you answer my question, by whose authority did John baptize? And we have that whole dialogue back and forth. Well, gee, you know, we can't really say that it was from God, because then he's going to ask us, well, why didn't you follow him? But if we say that he's from man, it's just a human thing that John did, the people are going to stone us and it's going to be riots in the streets. So we can't do that either. So they just do the typical modern thing of going, I don't know. And then our Lord says, fine. Then I won't tell you by what authority that I do these things either. Why? Because the disposition of your hearts and your manipulative, coercive, profiteering kind of mind of, well, if we do this, then that'll happen. If we do that, then this will happen. So let's just go, That is so human. It's the way we do things continually. It's why that's the origin oftentimes of our own sins. Because we kind of go, that's hard. Well, God is merciful, and therefore I can kind of like compromise somewhere down here. And this is what our Lord is pointing out in this clash, in this very vivid thing of the withering of this tree. Because then he goes out immediately, while they won't give the answer, they just shrug their shoulders. And he asks, then he goes out to give the parable of the two sons, that certainly you all know. When our Lord says that a man has two sons, and he asks his sons to go out and work in the field. And the first son that he asks, he says, no way, I'm not doing it. Old man, all you do is ask me to do stuff all the time. I am not your slave. Slam! And he walks out of the house. And then our Lord says, he goes a little bit, and he repents of that. He's grounding them. And he goes off and he works in the field. The other one sitting in the living room, when he asks him, you go out, please, and take care of the things in the barn, he says, oh, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. I'll do this right away. Yes, I love you, Dad. And we're told that he goes out. He just goes off and plays with his friends. He doesn't do anything in the barn, the fields. And our Lord says to the people who are listening to the parable, so which one of these two did the will of his father? Well, the obvious answer is, well, the first one, though he didn't really give a good answer, he actually did what his father asked him to do. And our Lord tells him, you've answered correctly. And that is the reason why many prostitutes and publicans and sinners are going to enter the kingdom of God before these scribes and these Pharisees. Because it's one thing to go, yeah, this is really tough, but what we do in the end, that is the reservoir of oil. So I encourage you, like I said, to go back and read these last chapters of each of the four Gospels during this time. Because our Lord tells us very clearly, the Gospel, to live the Gospel is not easy. It is not something which just happens. God doesn't just save us. He gives us the ability to be healed, to be transformed by that charity, and elevated and united with God within the Messiah. That is the path of salvation. This transformation that takes place in this man born in Bethlehem. And the Messiah gives us the ability to enter into this transformation, but it requires not only God's grace, but it requires our freedom to engage in that light and to receive the vessels of oil so our lamps do not extinguish before the last day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So we have our hymn then on page 15.
O Christ the Bridegroom, we welcome to meet you, O Lord, O Lord, open for us.
Fill our hearts, Lord, with the light of your kingdom.
We ask you, beg you, and knock at your door. O Lord, O Lord, open for us.
Fill our hearts, Lord, with the light of your kingdom.
We heard your voice, O Good Shepherd. For the lambs of your flock, you are the door. O Lord, open for us.
Fill our hearts, Lord, with the light of your kingdom.
O Lord, gate of mercies, open to us who knock and ask for your saving grace. Lead us to the light of your eternal kingdom. We are the children of your church, and with our lamps lit, we come to the church as to the harbor of our salvation. We offer glory to you forever.
Praise.
So we can try this using our other tone. Praise to him the night that saved us from our own burdens.
Trials and angels of
let us come and meet the Father.
And like the Lord, we believe.
Yitrahayam.
Alayim.
Alayim.
In the middle of the night they cry.
They all cry through his tongue. In their hands they all lie still with oil. Like a warm light in their face. And their heart like a burning flame.
Maronite Rahamalai.
Thank you.